Welcome back to the Geelong Region Soccer Show. It is episode 71, and we are now going to take a trip down memory lane, and helping us do that is our next guest. It's an absolute pleasure to have Roy Hay joining us. Roy, a very, very warm welcome to you, coming all the way from Bannockburn. How is it? Is it nice and cold in Bannockburn the way it is over here in Lara at the moment?
It's Scottish weather out here.
Scottish weather. it's the perfect weather to stay indoors, get a hot coffee, put us on the smart TV and take a lovely trip down memory lane. But before we do that, Roy, how have you been? How's life in retirement treating you? I know the last time I caught up with you said it's busier than ever.
Yeah, well, it is in many ways. I mean, I've had this, what I describe as a sabbatical for the last 2 or 3 years, because I've been researching and writing on Indigenous football, the footy game, not soccer. A couple of books came out, one on generally on Aboriginal people playing footy in the 19th century. I mean, there's a lot of talk about whether it was an Aboriginal game, for which I don't think there's much evidence at all. But in the years after the arrival of the Europeans, the few remaining Indigenous people saw the white men playing their game and thought they could do that, and they managed to force their way into it. In the periphery of Victoria, in the missions and stations where they were confined. And it's an untold story. There's a huge gap in the record, and I've tried to fill it with a couple of books. One, a more general book on their involvement in the local areas, but also recently a biography of a fellow called Purn Yarli Wari, better known as Albert or Jimmy Pompey Austin. Played one game for Geelong in 1872, and he is the only Indigenous player to do so, to play at the top level in Victoria in the whole of the 19th century. And it's not until the 1930s that you find people like Alf Egan and Doug Nicholls, Sir Doug Nicholls, forcing their way into the game. So this is an unsung hero. And next year it'll be 150 years since he played that game for the Geelong Footy Club. So there'll be a big celebration of that.
Now, Roy, when we're talking about the 19th century, football was quite big in Victoria around about that time. And in fact, it was, well, football, when we say football, association football. And then something happened where, unfortunately, Aussie rules got a head start on association football and never looked back. But if this hadn't happened, who knows? Soccer or football, as we call it, would have and possibly would have been the main sport. Now, tell us a bit what happened there in the wider Geelong region to give Aussie rules a little bit of a head start back in the day.
Yeah, it's really an interesting story, because in 1850, and this is only about 15 years after Geelong was founded, you find people playing 11-a-side and 6-a-side games of what I describe them as small-sided, 11 players, sometimes fewer, predominantly kicking games. Not that there might be a little bit of handling, as there was in early association football, but predominantly kicking, and they were played for money or for other prizes. Now, these existed all over Victoria, all over Australia after the Europeans arrived, and then in the 1850s, there was a massive rush to Victoria, people in search of gold. And at the end of that decade, in 1859, a group of the migrants drew up the rules for another form of football. And it was a very simple exercise, and it was based very heavily on English public school forms of the game, which had been played for many years. And backed by the initial founding group, nearly all of whom were either correspondents to the newspapers or were actual journalists, and they promoted this form of the game. And so the game that might have evolved easily into association football was more or less written out. And what happened in the next 20 years was that there was no influx of people to Victoria. In fact, people were leaving Victoria in numbers.
Because the gold rush was over, is that right?
The gold rush was over. And we had what I have described as footy's first free kick, because there simply wasn't a cohort of people with an association football background arriving to challenge the locals. And they had a bunch of people in the early days who, as I say, were not only players but journalists. So they promoted this game. And it wasn't that they were, as happened later on, that they were down on association football. It was out of pure ignorance. They had no idea what had been going on, and they had no challenge from overseas. So, as I say, for 20 years, footy had what was virtually a free kick. And by the time the next wave of migrants comes in the 1880s, footy is very well established. And although there are soccer matches in the 1880s, the first interstate games are played in 1883. There are cup and league competitions in Melbourne, in Victoria, and starting also in New South Wales, the first interstate matches are played in 1883. But from then on, soccer is always playing catch up.
And if we now look, what we're going to do, folks, is we're going to break it up into three parts effectively. So Roy's going to look at a pre-World War II, so the history of football in Geelong pre-World War II, and then from about the post-war years to about the 1970s, which coincided with the large influx of European migrants, and then from, I guess, the 1970s onto modern times. But we've got a photo here, Roy. Tell us a bit about this photo. 1930, and this was it the Madden Cup or something like that? Tell us a bit more about what happened there.
Well, we had a competition in Geelong in the late 20s, starting off with the Geelong United team, but then the woolen mills and other industrial firms started, the people who worked in these firms started forming football teams. The other type of team that was formed was one based on the heritage of the people who were playing. So that team, which won the Madden Cup, was Northumberland and Durham's. And the soccer people, this is quite interesting, is the soccer people from Scotland and from the north of England, Northumberland and Durham, they named their teams after their heritage rather than after the area where they settled. So if you like, the Scots and the Northern English were the first ethnics. They were the first wogs.
Isn't that interesting?
They set a pattern for soccer, which, of course, as you know, after the Second World War, there was this belief that soccer was a wicked foreign game. But in fact, it had this long history. But the first ethnics, as I say, were the Scots and the Northern English.
Now, we've got a photo there of the the Caledonian Shield, yes, the Geelong Scots. Mm. And that's, if you look very carefully, the shield actually has 1926 on it.
Exactly.
So tell us, was this a different tournament to the Madden Cup? Tell us a bit more about the Caledonian Cup.
Yeah, but can I say something else about the Caledonians? The Scots have started in this right at the beginning. There was a fella called Alex Bruce. People don't talk about this man. He was one of the founders of footy, and he was an incredible man. He lost a hand and the lower part of his arm, and he played footy with an iron hook in place of the hand. Now, you can't even wear a ring when you're playing soccer.
Yeah.
Can you imagine somebody playing footy with an iron hook and dishing out a bit of violence? He was dead against kicking shins, but he caused a bit of mayhem. Now, the first trophy for footy was presented by the Melbourne Caledonian Society. And in a similar way, in Geelong, the Caledonian Shield was the first trophy that they played for in the middle of the interwar period. In those days, it was for what was effectively a cup competition. And it finished up in the hands of Geelong Scottish, who promptly won it in the post-war period, when it was used as the trophy for a league competition. And Geelong Scottish won it three times in a row. And as with the original Caledonian Cup in the 19th century, Geelong Scottish were, because they'd won it three in a row, they got to keep the cup, the shield, and it sits behind the bar at Myers Reserve to this day.
There you go. On the on the screen there, we've got a lady called Jean McCauley with the Madden Cup. Now, what's Jean's connection
well,
to the Madden
Jean's
Cup?
Jean's father, John Madden, presented this trophy for competition in the late 1927. And so that was the cup competition for which they played. And that cup still exists in Geelong.
Oh, fascinating, fascinating. Roy, then we move on towards the Second World War. Was there much in between, like, you know, I suppose the Great Depression, the 1930s, and then leading up towards the Second World War? Was there much activity right up until the end of the war in Geelong?
Not really, because soccer once again shot itself in the foot.
Second free kick.
In 1927. Now, it's incomprehensible, this split, because you had two bodies in Geelong claiming to run the game. In Melbourne and Geelong trying to run the game. And they were virtually indistinguishable. That happened in 1927. So for 3 years, you had two competitions going on. And then, of course, the Great Depression hit. And that just knocked soccer sideways. And it never really recovered. There was a team in Geelong, whereas previously there'd been a league. And very interestingly, in 1937, a fella called J.J. Liston. Now, does that name mean anything to you?
Sounds like a VFL trophy.
Doesn't it? Liston Trophy.
He was the head of what had started off as the VFL, but became the VFA after the big split. He volunteered to take over as president of soccer. And he did a remarkable amount of good for the game. He managed to get some money out of the Football Association in England, and he kept the game alive at a time when it was as with most sports, struggling in the 1930s, and then handed over to people like Harry Armstrong. And another figure that we really ought to remember with as one of the major contributors to the game, Harry Docherty from Glasgow, that's Docherty with a K, who helped to restart the game in Geelong, in Melbourne before the First World War, and was still going until he died in 1965, still in harness as the president of the Victorian Soccer Federation.
And after whom the Docherty Cup is named after.
Absolutely. Obviously. He presented that cup in 1909. He played in the final for his own team, St Kilda, but they lost to Carlton, so he had to present his own trophy to the captain of the other team.
Oh, that would have been hard to buy. Roy, thank you very much. We're going to take a little bit of a break. When we return, we'll continue with the next part. Welcome back to the Geelong Region Soccer Show. It is a very, very interesting and an educational episode tonight. We are speaking with leading Australian and local football historian, author Roy Hay. And we've just had a little bit of a trip down memory lane, Roy, looking at football in Geelong before the Second World War. Obviously, during the Second World War, not much happened. But then things started to get really exciting, coinciding with the big influx of migrants, which happened over several waves from the 50s or right through till about the 70s, I say. Tell us a bit about some of the clubs that particularly in the 50s, rose to prominence in Geelong and what happened with soccer or football in Geelong in that period.
Yeah, the game was kept alive by people like Harry Armstrong and, as I say, Harry Docherty. But when the migrants began to arrive in numbers, they immediately began to become involved in the game because this is the game they brought with them. They had soccer in their blood and they were determined that they would continue with the game. The point I think that is sometimes overlooked is how important the soccer clubs turned out to be, not just for what they did on the field, but what they provided to these new migrants who arrived often with no English, with no knowledge of Australian society. Many of them had really wanted to go to America or Canada, but finished up here, not unlike a Jewish fellow who came on an immigrant ship. And when he found that the destination was Australia, he just jumped overboard. but for those who got here,
fair enough.
The soccer clubs were often the bridge into this strange society. I've often said that the sensible migrant arriving in Australia looks for a job, gets himself a house, a roof over his head. They're mostly male, the ones I'm talking about, and then looks around for a family. And that, I think, is the common pattern. But if you ask me, I've got a list as long as my arm of people who arrived in Australia and went straight down the soccer club. And it was the soccer club that got them the job, got them the house, and in many cases got them the family as well. Mm. And taught them Australian English, taught them about this strange
Australian English
society in which they found themselves, and so on. Because there were no, there were good neighbor councils and there were churches and so on, but there were so few organizations in those days set up to cater for migrants. And so the soccer clubs filled that gap. I mean, several of the clubs that I know about actually ran language courses for their people.
Yep.
And of course, they were, if you like, the place where you could go and pick up knowledge from the immediately preceding group of migrants, and they would help you come to terms with Australian society. And they also played blooming good soccer as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Roy, you talk about a lot of these players getting met as they arrived on the boat and poached to go and play for a certain team.
Oh, there
was one player that you found out about that was asked to go and play for a certain team. He couldn't understand his teammates' vocabulary, but it turned out that his opponents, he could understand, and ended up changing teams.
That was Fred Nogler, Robbie Nogler's dad. Fred arrived and went to Croatia, and they were playing Karajo, who were German at that stage, and or at least had a number of German speakers in the team. Yeah. And this is the situation in which he found himself. Chris Van Beek had a slightly different experience, because he turned up and also went to Croatia. And I think the first or second game, there was an all-in brawl in which 21 of the 22 players took part. He stood on the sidelines, observing this strange behavior. On the 30th night, he was hauled up before the committee and told, "You play for Croatia, you fight for Croatia."
There you go. Wise words.
Well, we're going to ask about the league that kicked off around 1950 with about four clubs as it began.
Yeah, it began as we had both a local competition, and some of the clubs were also taking part in Melbourne competition. This is the International Harvester team, isn't it?
Yes, it is. The 1951 team from International Harvester. And they were one of
great
the four
uniforms.
Teams. Is that right? I know.
Look at those colours.
Most of the teams in those early days had some kind of backing, either from a business, Shell, for example, International Harvester. Others, there was a team called Celtic, would you believe?
Yep.
It turned out that they went through the league like a dose of salts in 1950 and then disappeared completely the next season. And you really needed to know that Geelong Celtic came out of the Teachers Training College at Lunan House, and they were a bunch of British migrants. And they were all here to train as teachers. And of course, after they'd done their year's training, they were sent off to the wilds of rural Victoria to teach, and the team disappeared. So you had some teams which lasted and others which flourished like a comet and then disappeared.
Well, one of those clubs that sort of flourished, I guess, in the early days and then sort of morphed into what is today the Geelong Rangers Soccer Club was the club that you mentioned earlier, Geelong Scottish. And there's a photo of them, the League and Corio Cup winners in 1958. An interesting story. They were founded in 1955 in the North Geelong Fire Station. Do we know much about, you know, the early days of the Geelong Rangers Soccer Club, or Geelong Scottish as it was known?
Well, the guy who's sitting smack bang in the middle with the specs is Billy Dorris Sr. And
Billy
is classic case. He arrived here, went down the soccer club, broke his collarbone in the first game, and it was the club that looked after him while he recovered from that. He was one of five brothers that arrived from Scotland, one of whom tragically died in a motor accident. But Billy was a classic of the kind of people I'm talking about. They arrive here and it's the club that looks after him and gets him fit again. And from then on, as you know, he was a power in the land at Rangers for many years. Then he had a falling out with the club and he did the same sort of thing at Bell Park. And he had two sons important in the game, Billy Dorris Jr. and Eddie Dorris, both of whom contributed a huge amount to generations of young Geelong players over the years. So it's a classic story of the kind I've been trying to tell.
Now there's a on the Geelong Rangers website, there's a little bit of a history about the club, and this is written by Paul Miller, so we must give Paul credit for this. And there it is. We actually put this up on our Facebook page during the week, and it says in 1955 in the North Geelong Fire Station, six men, and this is interesting, one woman and a teenage boy were holding a meeting that would shape the face of Geelong soccer for decades to come. So even back in the 50s, when I guess women weren't so involved in any sport or in things like this, the Rangers or Geelong Scottish had one woman involved in, and how ironic or coincidental that years later, the last two presidents of the Geelong Rangers have been women in Kylie Chapman and Lisa Brooks. So the club was very, very progressive even back in the 1950s.
Yeah. It's interesting because I have a strange relationship with Geelong Rangers. They've been very good to me, very good to a generation of youngsters that I helped to get to the National Youth League. On the other hand, I find the Scots, in some cases, are the most clannish of the lot. It's just interesting from a personal point of view. That's all.
Now, are we going to hear some history, family history, from you, Roy, that you had a grandfather who actually ended up playing for Glasgow Celtic? Is that the reason why they were a bit indifferent to you? And you've actually written a book about that, haven't you?
Yes, I have, and it sits, I must say, it sits in pride of place on Ange Postecoglou's desk at Celtic Park today. There's a photograph of his father, and propped alongside it is the story of my grandfather. Because he was captain of Celtic when they won the league and won the Scottish League six times in a row. This is going back before the First World War.
There you go. Interesting stuff. Wow. Now, in the 1950s, the Hungarian community was quite significant in those days, straight on the back of, I guess, the post-war migration, but also the Hungarian uprising of the mid-50s. And there were, in fact, not just one, but two Hungarian clubs in the 50s. One of those was Toldi, and they're on the screen. Tell us a bit more about the Hungarian involvement in local football, which has continued to this present day in some shape or form.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know that the Hungarian revolution occurred just around the time of the Melbourne hosting the Olympic Games in 1956. So there were a lot of Hungarians had already begun migrating to Geelong and Victoria. But obviously, when the Russians invaded and when the country was taken over by communism, many, many more made their way overseas. And Geelong benefited from this. And as you say, there were at least two Hungarian teams, and Hungarians played for many of the other teams as well. So there was a very considerable influence on the game for that period after 1957-58.
And I guess one of the one of the most well-known Hungarians that was to arrive in Australia post-war and post the Hungarian Revolution was none other than Les Murray, the famous Les Murray, whose name was
Urge, yes.
Exactly right. Now, in the 50s, speaking of another community that I'm quite obviously connected to, this community that was very significant for the development of soccer or football in Geelong was the Croatian community. Now, obviously, people know that North Geelong Warriors is a Croatian community-backed club, but prior to that, there were, in fact, two Croatian clubs in Geelong, one that is no longer around, this one on the photo, and another one that eventually was to become the Melbourne Knights, or what is today the Melbourne Knights. But this club, Zagreb, in 1959, now I've got a family link here. The gentleman in the top left-hand corner, Marko Voladovic, was actually a pioneer of the Croatian community here in Geelong. And he is single-handedly the reason why my parents came out in the late 60s from Germany, where they were living for a year, because he's actually my great-grand-uncle, I think it is, or how it works, my mum's side of the family. And an interesting story here. In Germany, 1968, all the immigrants were told that they would have to leave. It was only a rumour, by the way. And my parents, having fled communist Yugoslavia at the time, said, no way are we going to go back to Yugoslavia. And my mum said, I think I've got a great uncle somewhere in Australia, wherever that is. And Roy, at the time, in the late 60s, there was a white Australia policy where a lot of Europeans were being brought out to Australia for all sorts of reasons with a one-way ticket, all paid for by the Australian government. And around about that time, there was a massive influx of migrants to Geelong. And as we said, one of those was HNK Zagreb. There's a lot of familiar faces, and we'll put that up there. But that was the start of soccer really, really growing in a major way.
Yes, absolutely. And the Zagreb and Croatia, the Croatian club began in Melbourne. There was... followed quickly by a club in Geelong, also Croatia. And Joe Radojevic, who was the secretary of the club, got a phone call from his opposite number in Melbourne, who said, we are short of players for a cup match. Can you help us out? Joe said, yes. How many players do you need? He said, 7 and a goalkeeper.
Just a little bit short.
just a little bit, yeah.
Some idea. So eventually, Joe brought Melbourne Croatia to Geelong, and it played in Geelong from really throughout most of the 50s, from about 54 to 59. When they won the league and should have been promoted into the top division. But there was a bit of trouble going on off the field, and Preston Technical School Old Boys, as they were in those days, run by the Leopold brothers, had put in a protest against Lions and won an extra point. And so they became the promoted team rather than Croatia. I could go on at great length about the splits and what happened thereafter, but the point is that it took Croatia a while to settle down after these events. And eventually the club did move to Melbourne, but they did retain a presence in Geelong until 1972, when the Melbourne Croatia Club was suspended after trouble when a referee was attacked at the game in Melbourne. And so happened that year that the Geelong Croatian club was also kicked out of the league. And it took a couple of years for that to simmer down, and eventually the Croatians took over the Essendon Lions from the Ukrainian community, and eventually that evolved into Essendon Croatia and now Melbourne Croatia and Melbourne Knights.
There's some more old photos there of, and that is the Croatia club. So we're not too sure. Maybe Roy, you can tell us if that was from the 50s or the 60s era. But I'm really, really fascinated by this photo. That's 1962. Mostly fascinated by the fact that it's in color. Most of the photos are black and white, and this one's in color. So goodness me, there was a very, very good, either this has been touched up or there was a very, very good photographer or graphic designer back in 1960.
I think it's somebody's good colorizer. I think so.
Yeah, because like I said,
everyone's
most of
very
those
well
photos,
dressed in that picture. Yeah,
I know. I mean, you look, go back to that photo. Yeah, people are so dapper back in those days. Yeah. I mean, we know in the 1920s and 30s, people used to walk around very well dressed up, and even at the turn of the century and back in the gold rush era. But this is early 60s. Everyone is looking very, very.
You wouldn't see that at a club these days around the area.
No. You'd stop on moccasins and
tracksuit pants only.
the occasional singlet here and there, and what you're not. But look, before we sort of look at the last era, sort of from the 70s onwards, I guess, what was some of the most significant, some of the significant clubs of the 1960s, I suppose, or 50s and 60s that weren't around, that aren't around any longer, Roy, that, had such a big impact on football in Geelong?
A lot of the clubs changed names over this period. I mean, we talked about Geelong Scottish becoming Hamlin Rangers and then becoming Geelong Rangers. The Carrial Club grew out of Geelong British and existed under its own name for a while, but then had an amalgamation with the Italians of Geelong United and played with this double-barreled name of Carrial Geelong United for many years. Mm. And then they were taken over by what had been Northern Suburbs, which was the surviving Hungarian club. We talked about Toldy in the early days. Later on, Northern Suburbs was founded, and that was very much a Hungarian club. Mm. And that Hungarian influence eventually took over the club we now know as Carrial, and it's still very strong to this day.
Sorry, I was going to say in the 50s, when the Geelong League kicked off, the Dutch were big. I mean, that's, I think, taken from a website. I think it's called, I can't remember what the name of it. It's got a funny name, definitely. But
The Clash of the Clogs.
And it actually says right down the bottom, several Dutch teams emerged in Victoria in the 50s. Three sides were established in Geelong in quick succession: Shell, Olympia, and DSG, which is the Dutch Society of Geelong. Now, there was quite over the years, and I guess we'd recognise some of the surnames. There were quite a few Dutchmen who were very, very heavily involved in football in Geelong, and now their offspring or their grandkids are now starting to come through the fore. And some of those names we'd know today. Did you want to talk a bit about the Dutch influence as well?
Well, remember that the Shell company is Royal Dutch Shell. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of people come from the Netherlands direct. But there are also people who come from what was the Dutch East Indies, now modern-day Indonesia. So there are two strands that feed into the Dutch migration to Australia. And again, people like Peter Langedijk is another of those migrants who arrived and got himself injured and got down the soccer club and so on. So he fits my model. And as you say, there were several Dutch clubs. Olympia had three teams at one point. There was Wilhelmina. There was, I'm just trying to remember, there was the Dutch Society of Geelong, the DSG. So the interesting thing about the Dutch to me is that they had this huge influence over a very, very brief period. Mm-hmm. And then the Dutch seemed to disappear, whereas some of the other migrant communities had a strong and continuing influence in the game, obviously Croatians, Macedonians, and others. So you've got this pattern that is quite different as far as the Dutch are concerned.
They're
hugely influential in the early days and then really have less direct influence.
Now, there's a photo there of the old Hume Reserve, and that is like, I think, pitch two, but further down towards Separation Street, you could see that there was another pitch, but there was a further pitch a little bit to the north, I suppose, and then further up the top near Barton Street where there is one pitch now. So in total, Hume Reserve had like six pitches at the height of its popularity, I suppose. When did Hume Reserve, when did Bell Park really become kind of like the mecca or the heartbeat of Geelong soccer? Was that sort of in the 60s and the 70s? Did that sort of coincide with the formation of North Geelong or Geelong Croatia in 1967?
I'm not absolutely sure on that. I mean, what happened with Bell Park, you had a bunch of youngsters who were not getting a game at IAMA, the Italian Australian Migrants Association, which was the name that Geelong Football Club, Soccer Club, adopted in the mid-50s, playing in Inter Milan, dark blue and black stripes. So these kids went up to Bell Park and they started in central Geelong and then later on built this big club room and soccer pitch at Batesville. Although they're often regarded as Italian, that you can see that they tried to set their face against becoming a club of one group of migrants.
Yep.
There's still a strong Italian influence, but it's not a simple one club, one migrant group at Bell Park.
And is that where Geelong United then kind of fused as another, like it was, I guess, Mario Gregorio, who's today the president of Corio Soccer Club. And I think we can move along to that now. I think there's a photo of Geelong United here. There we go. There's a photo of Geelong United. This is, now we're into the 80s, but that was, look at some of the hairstyles there. There's Rob Parmachotti, bottom left-hand, second from the left on the bottom. And who's that? That's right in the middle of the... Yeah, look at that hairstyle right in the middle, fourth from the left on the top. Do we know who that is? But God, this is the 80s now. But is that where Geelong United came, sort of a little bit of a splinter from Bell Park? As you said, players weren't getting a go, and then another Italian club was sort of formed that was Geelong United.
That's correct. Yeah, but I mean, you've got Pat Whelan on the right at the back. He's not Italian, he's Scottish. just trying to
Dinko Ullar, I think the bottom left or in the yeah, sorry, go on.
Yeah, go on, Serge.
Is Dinko Ullar, I think he is. Dinko, the yeah. Croatian player, and he was a famous cabinet maker in North Geelong.
Game at North, so yeah.
And now Joe Pante, who's watching this and is tuning in the comments section, he said, my uncle Vince Mortelliti was president and the first life member of the Geelong United Soccer Club. There you go. Thank you. And Gene Digia Domenico says goalkeeper Frank Gamina.
Yes.
Is that right? There you go. Thank you very much for that, Gene Digia.
This is where your listeners can provide lots of information, because they're family members, there are people you grew up with, and so on. Yeah,
excellent. Now, what we might do, gents, is we might take a little bit of a break, and we'll have a little bit of a chance just to have a bit of a rest. And then what we'll do is we'll look at the mid-70s to the modern era, where there was quite a fair few clubs, quite a fair few hairstyles as well. Looking forward to that. And we'll talk about the more modern era and a lot of clubs came and went in the recent era. So don't go away, folks. It's the Geelong Region Soccer Show Trip Down Memory Lane episode.
Affordable Cleaning Supplies is a Geelong-based family-owned and operated business that has been involved in the cleaning supplies industry for many years, specializing in the sales and distribution of a large range of quality commercial and domestic cleaning products. Affordable Cleaning Supplies aims to save their customers both time and money. They pride themselves on quality products and exceptional customer service, and their service includes providing a no obligation free of charge site audit to find best practice procedures for your business, offering a prompt daily delivery service to Geelong and the Surf Coast by utilising their own delivery vehicles, courier services, and Australia Post to provide fast and cost-effective delivery solutions, offering free on-loan dispensing equipment for most of their products, as well as supplying environmentally friendly green options wherever possible. They can even arrange product training for all of your staff. And best of all, they offer a procurement service to find products you are having trouble sourcing. Visit their showroom, which is open to the public at 32A Gordon Avenue in Geelong West, to view an extensive range of products on display. Affordable Cleaning Supplies also has a sister company, Affordable Hospitality, opening soon at 11 Crown Street in South Geelong. Come and see them for all your hospitality equipment and food packaging needs. Give Affordable Cleaning Supplies a call on 1300 650 277, or visit their website at www.affordable.com.
Welcome back to the Geelong Region Soccer Show. It's an absolute pleasure having Roy Hay with us tonight, leading Australian football historian, author, retired academic, and researcher indeed. Roy, we were talking about Geelong United just before the break. Let's return to Geelong United. Mid-80s, I guess they were playing... Was it a Hume Reserve, or were they playing out at East Geelong at the time?
I think that was the case, yes.
And what was their journey thereafter, and how did they end up to what it is today, the Corio Soccer Club?
They had a mercurial existence. I don't know how they managed to survive for as long as they did. I think it was the case that this was really a takeover of the Italian club by what was previously, as I say, Northern Suburbs. They had some superb players. They had a coach, Tiziano Cavalieri, who talked a brilliant game and did some very good things, but was a bit mercurial, and I think that it was always, it seemed to me, a train wreck about to happen, and finally it was taken over or amalgamated with Carayo.
Yeah, one of the other clubs around about that time also that was rose to prominence, particularly in the 70s, was a British club or Brinton's, and they were formed off the back of the carpet factory, wasn't it, in Breakwater, and were located just literally around the corner from where today Breakwater Eagles is situated.
Yeah, a fella called Brian Pugh, who was also the secretary of the Western Victorian Soccer Association, the local league. He was the driving force behind it, and they had a bunch of very good young kids at Breakwater. There's one in his veteran stage, Johnny Cow, in the middle of a puddle.
He went on to referee quite a fair bit.
Paul Mills just visible at the back right. Playing against Croatia, and there's many of the youngsters there in that team that who are all named in the photograph.
Now that's one of the junior teams, because they were very strong as a junior club as well, wasn't they? Well, wasn't Brinton's, like, they had a fairly significant junior section to the club, and a lot of those players went on to bigger and better things.
Yeah, and they had Paul Halliday, who did wonders for Geelong soccer in so many ways. He came through Brinton's and developed into an absolutely excellent coach, and really did a great deal for the game locally.
Now, big shout out to Kevin Henderson, who has provided us with a lot of photos of and Miro Zanić as well. Miro was very good in providing some photos in, and I think there's one here of Miro in action. Now, he was a goalkeeper for Croatia, and towards the end of his career he ended up being a player in the Western Victorian Soccer Association rep team as an outfield player. And this is a photo that Miro actually sent to us, and that was I dare say it was probably a Geelong Advertiser Cup game against Brinton's, because back in those days, well, the Advertiser Cup started in 81. Back in those days, Roy, the WVSA team used to put a select side in each tournament, didn't they? And how'd they used to go?
Well, the competition began in 81. First competition was at Bell Park, won by Bell Park, who had a strong team in those days, with Ray Pocock, player coach, it was a marvelous competition. It came out of the events of 1981, when they set up what they called the Association of Geelong Clubs, with a view to creating a team to play at National League level, which unfortunately never happened. We should have done that. I mean, the whole ethos at the time was that Geelong should have a team of its own to represent the area. But all the individual clubs, you would find that whichever club was doing well that year would decide that it could do it better on its own. And as a result, they pulled in different directions. None of them were able to sustain that for a great length of time, and we really missed an opportunity to create a team to represent Geelong. If we had one today, I think things would be much different.
Yeah, it's such a shame. I imagine we'd have a lot more football infrastructure if that was the case. But moving along to 1985, we've got a photo of a WVSA team coming up here, looking splendid in their kits with the white with the blue stripe. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a bit about that pitcher at all?
Well, let's start with the goalkeeper. The absolutely incredible Everett Nelson, who is 2 years older than me and I can't catch him. He is still as good a human being as it's possible to meet, and has bred two generations of contributors. His son Darren and his two grandsons have also played in Geelong. But it's a fair old team. There's Seth Early, second from the left in the front row, who've been around forever, ever. Also a very good player, but Seth would kick you off the park if he wasn't getting his way. Next to him, unfortunately, the late Peter Stamatovsky, who died tragically very young. Frank Sullivan, the fellow at the extreme left.
Some good names there, good faces. And Everett Nelson was playing well into his, I think, 70s, maybe even early 80s.
Oh, yes.
In the very first Geelong Masters competition, so that's about 5 years ago. And I'll never forget, it was Drysdale versus North Geelong. I was playing for North Geelong. Alongside me, there's Josip Skoko, ex-Socceroo. And then in the Drysdale goals was none other than Everett Nelson. It was surreal. It was just amazing. Yeah. And players from both sides were just pitching themselves that night. It was down at Alco Park on pitch number 2. Cold, wet, windy night. Floodlights were on, but my goodness me, it was like a lot of kids, big kids reliving their dream. But it was phenomenal. The WVSA side, or Western Victorian Soccer Association side, obviously represented an association that is no longer around. But this next photo is of a very, very prominent referee at the time, who went on to become the long term. Some would say president, others would say dictator of the Western Victorian Soccer Association, the famous or infamous Joe Capadonna. He was a very colourful character. But next to him, Roy, is none other than the now former president of North Geelong Warriors, a young man then, and he's certainly got hair, is a young John Didelitzer. Now, that was at
Bell Park. And can you see what John is saying? Has Capadonna done this time?
Joe's got a bit of a smile on his face, but look at the crowd. That was at the Bell Park Sports Club.
Probably a last-minute decision that affects the course of the game or something like that. He loved doing that. Another good player.
It's the smile on the face.
Behind him is Nick Plummer, was a student at Deakin. Was the player of the tournament when we hosted the inter-varsity tournament in Geelong. And he and Craig, his brother, played really good quality soccer later, starting off in the WVSA, but later with the Geelong Soccer Club.
Yeah. Interesting stuff there. Interesting stuff. Now, when it was the WVSA rep team back in the 90s, this is an interesting story, and I can remember this quite clearly. Back in the 90s, the only time you'd ever get Croatians and Serbians playing together was in the WVSA rep team. Now, that's probably a little bit earlier, but that's the 85. But in the 90s, you had them playing together. Speaking of the Serbs, they had a club in the 1990s that were quite prominent, quite strong in the local competition. But unfortunately for them, I guess, they quickly fizzled out because I guess they never had a junior club, or they had a few junior teams. Norlane West. Now, there's a lot of famous faces there. Tell us a little bit about the rise and fall of Norlane West, who today have got a little bit of a kind of a presence in the local league, I suppose. One of the Corio soccer club teams in the local competition is, in fact, Norlane West in drag, they basically have the same kits and everything like that. And a lot of the players, and they almost run the team separately. But going back to the 90s, Norlane West, where did they play? And tell us a little bit about this club.
That's not really much I can tell. They took over the ground that Northern Suburbs vacated, didn't they?
Yep. Kariah Community Reserve out of Hendy Street. Yes, I do believe that's the case. Yeah. Yeah.
Where they play American football these days.
Aye, yeah. And then there was another team formed from, the college in the northern suburbs, beyond Hendy Street, beyond the end of Hendy Street.
Oh, yeah, the old, was it Kariah Bay or, what was
Kariah
it called?
Bay or
Kariah North or something like that, yeah.
I'm not sure why the club folded. If, as you say, they didn't bring through a group of juniors, then this is a recipe for disaster, because people get burned out by the game and move on. Mm. Unless you've got really a range of generations involved in the club, it's very hard to sustain it. You need the playing generation to move into managing and supporting, and their children to come through into your top team. And if you don't have that pattern, then clubs fold very quickly.
Fun fact, the gentleman there in the back holding the cup, that's Mladen Spasojevic, who was a long-time captain. And his son, Nemanja Spasojevic, I think went through the Geelong Soccer Club youth ranks and then has ended up playing at Werribee City. And Steve, I think we've called a few times when the North Geelong played Werribee City, or he's been in that team a few times. So, there's been a few talented players come through the ranks from this team. Now, one of the clubs, there's quite a fair few clubs around about that time, Roy, Geelong Espanyol, Geelong Olympic, Corio Cloverdale, I think the Turkish team, Geelong Star, it might have been called. But another one around that time in the 80s and 90s that rose to prominence, we haven't got many photos, but this is a photo of the Ukrainian club up at Lovely Banks, which was home to Lovely Banks Kiev. Now, they were a very, very strong club. Tell us a little bit about all of those clubs that were quite prominent in the 80s and 90s.
Mm. Yeah, I thought Lovely Banks Kiev would kick on, because you can see that they established a building. They had a good pitch, and they had youngsters. But for some reason or other, it's got to do with the chain migration, which sustained a lot of the clubs, that you'd get people would come to Geelong, and then there would be more than a trickle of successors would come from that part of the world, when they found out how successful the people who'd come to Australia and Geelong had been. That helped to sustain many of the migrant clubs. On the other hand, you also needed the founding generation to set up a structure that would provide the basis for long-term success. And if your community was small, or if migration fell away, it's often very difficult for migrant communities to sustain themselves over more than a generation. The other thing is, of course, that in many ways, the soccer clubs were too successful in the sense that the people who arrived here found their way into Australian society and therefore didn't have as much need of the club as their parental generation did. And it's been fascinating to see this going to play out with the modern generation. I mean, we've got people now, we've got the Karens from Asia, we've got the South Sudanese from Africa. We're getting migrants from different parts of the world. And they are going through potentially the same experience that your parental generation did, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I this is an interesting conversation that Maria Gregoria has got a lot of interesting stories to tell about Karaya's soccer club and the Karini and the Afghani communities and you know they've their involvement with a lot of these newer communities as well. And I know through my involvement at the Leisure Time Sports Precinct, there's quite a fair few of the Karini members of the Karini community. They love their football, they love their futsal, and often in many cases they just now do it very informally. They get together, have a kick, and you know, from first-hand experiencing watching some of these guys play, they're absolutely incredibly gifted, incredibly skilled, and it's just a shame that a lot of them don't play football, and for whatever reason, whether they can't afford it, whether
cost is a bad thing,
Sorry,
carry on.
I say there's a bunch of Karens playing at Bannockburn with Golden Plains nowadays.
Yep. Yeah, it's a lot of the younger kids, coming through the ranks.
I always feel for them because physically I see them come up against guys who are twice as tall as they are, and it really puts an awful lot of strain on them. They don't get a chance to display the skills that they have often.
Now, some of the other clubs, we had Joe Ormino, the CEO of the Gordon, on a few months back, and he told us how, in fact, it was probably Joe that gave us the idea to start looking at some of these clubs that aren't around. And he was being of Spanish extraction, and he was saying how he was at a time involved with Espanyol. And there were, like we said, Geelong Olympic, and that was something that I've always been intrigued. Geelong had quite a large Greek community, but it could never really take off and have a big football presence in the way that, I guess, the Halluses and Heidelbergs of Melbourne or Sydney Olympics of Sydney and almost every other city in Australia has. What was the situation with that?
There is a reason for that. And I was like you. I mean, I always wondered why that didn't happen. But the bulk of the migrants from Greece who came to Geelong specifically tended to come from the islands. They were fisher folk. They weren't urban Greeks. And they didn't have a football tradition like the Turkish-orientated Greeks and the urban Greeks.
Yep.
And that was one of the reasons why it was very late in the process that Geelong Olympic was set up, and perhaps why it folded very quickly. You know, there wasn't another generation coming through that to sustain it.
Fascinating, fascinating. Roy, thank you so much for your rather informative insight into the history of Geelong soccer and some of the clubs that were, you know, that graced our region. I was going to say graced our presence, Steve, but neither you nor I are that old that we probably don't remember much of this. But it's.
Can I interrupt just for a moment?
Because absolutely.
One of the people who has been listening to this, watching it, said something about who were the greatest players to come to Geelong.
Yes, that was, I think it was Daniel Stocky, who, yes, he was,
could have been that,
here we go.
Yeah.
We'll pop that question up there. There you go. Daniel Stocky.
Shout out to Daniel. Well done, mate. I enjoyed watching you. You're as good a player as some of the ones I've seen. But, I mean, we've had everybody. We've had Bobby Charlton more than once. We've had George Best. We've had...
Tommy Cumming. Can't forget Tommy Cumming.
Well, if you talk about the ones who have been here and stayed here for a significant period, you've got people like Frank Munro, Tommy Cumming, Greg Chapnick, and then we've got the homebred ones.
Before my time, there was a fella at North Geelong, Croatia, and they people said he was one of the best footballers that people they'd ever seen. And unfortunately, industrial accident cut that short because he became a paraplegic in a wheelchair. Steve Vujkovic. Do you know much about him?
Well, I didn't see him play, unfortunately. But everybody raved about him. I mean, illness killed two of Geelong's best because Darren Tuck.
Player I do remember him.
Real quality. But if the
cancer wasn't it?
Was
it cancer? I think was it that he succumbed to cancer?
I think it was motor neuron disease. There've been lots of players. Some came for brief periods. Some came and stayed for significant periods. Slobodan Jovanovic was a player of real quality. We perhaps didn't see him in his prime, but Suki was a gentleman and B, an absolutely brilliant player and a huge influence at Bell Park. If you go back to the early days, we must have had one or two of the top stars of their time. People like Sergio Bassi, who played with Geelong. Penso, the goalkeeper, who started at Geelong and went to Melbourne. They were in that Geelong Italian team at the prime. And in terms of, you know, the domestic players that we produced, Chris Trajanovski, Skoko, Josip Skoko, Steve Horvat, senior and junior. We've got through our time in Geelong, we've been privileged to have at least some stages of the career of top players, either on the way up or perhaps when they passed their prime. I think of Bogdan Bonk.
Polish rifle.
Not Geelong, the Polish rifle. I mean, he was a player of immaculate talent. I mean, he do things with the ball. He was so unfortunate that he missed being part of that classic Polish team that did so well in the World Cups. He was the next man to be selected, but he never got into the top Olympic or World Cup teams. But we had some of the best of his playing career, and he coached very well as well.
Mate, we could go on and on and on, and we surely could, but unfortunately, we're going to have to draw the line there. Thank you to everyone who's tuned in tonight, and there's some great names and people we haven't heard for a long time, but I'll have to leave you with this. Jamie Mallon, with his comment, Roy Hay was one of the best junior coaches I ever had. So thank you, Jamie, for those sentiments.
Jamie, you're a liar.
good on Jamie Mallon there.
I love you.
absolute pleasure having you on board, and we certainly will love, you know, it's been a phenomenally interesting and certainly probably one of the longest episodes of the Geelong Region Soccer Show. We'll have to get this topic going, and who knows, next week we might even get some guests on from some of those former clubs to talk about what life was like back in the 70s, 80s and 90s, now that we've got no football in the present moment.